This Sportz Blitz podcast is brought to you by LMG. Grow your business through logo design, paper products, and video production. Visit leemarketing.net to learn more.
Welcome back to Sportz Blitz Live. This segment brought to you by Russell Medical Center. Everybody over at Russell Medical Center does a fantastic job. One of the top 100 hospitals in the country, right here in Alexander City, Alabama. Really do appreciate their sponsorship of the program. And right now, I'm very happy to be joined by Barrett Sallee from BleacherReport.com. Bleacher Report, one of the best sites out there. I check it all the time, and it's an honor to have you with us, Barrett.
Well, it's my pleasure. Thank you for having me.
No problem at all. Well, listen, I was going to talk about a few other things, but as I look on the site, I see there's this article about Mike Slive and possibly breaking away. Of course, it's not going to happen right now, but he's thrown some possibilities out there.
Yeah, he's sort of going with that Teddy Roosevelt style of walking softly and carrying a big city. He's a really soft-spoken guy, but pretty terse words yesterday at the Associated Press editors meeting in Birmingham. I think that he takes the fact that full cost of attendance scholarships have not been passed. I think he takes that personally. I think Jim Delaney does too, and I think they're serious about the possible split of FBS. And quite honestly, I think it's probably the right move for everybody involved because, and I wrote in my story today, the budget for Alabama is completely different than the bottom line for South Alabama, and Texas San Antonio is completely different than Texas. So, you know, why should those schools decide what happens at the top of the division? So I think, the money being generated by college football is huge. The players deserve a proportionate share. They do get paid in other ways through scholarships and training and all that other stuff. But you know, covering that gap, that small gap between what's covered in an athletic scholarship and the full cost of attendance, I think is necessary. And quite honestly, $2,000 isn't even enough. You look at some of the estimates that some of these schools have. LSU's $3,600. Auburn is $5,400. That gap is pretty big. So it's a pretty significant gap. And I think that he's serious. That's his, I think, going to be what he feels his legacy in college football is going to be about the full cost of attendance. And I think he's that passionate about it, and I think that's why he was so upset yesterday.
Yeah, and one thing that we should all do is take Mike's life pretty seriously. I mean, he's done a lot of fabulous things with the Southeastern Conference and has absolutely flourished under his leadership. There's no doubt about it. Where do you see college football going, say, 10 years from now? I mean, are we going to have 64 big boy teams and then some of these smaller programs that you mentioned a little bit earlier, they're just going to be a de facto Division I AA again?
Yeah, there'll be, a little sandwich division in between, and I think you've already seen that. You know, I think you've already seen that divide already happening. You know, the Big East / American Athletic Conference lost their AQ status in the new system. There are the Power 5 conferences and the other five conferences, the Group of Five, and I think that will be the new divide, and honestly, it kind of already happened because the recruits that are attracted to SEC and ACC and Big 12 and Big 10 schools aren't interested in the MAC and they're not interested in the Sun Belt. So you're sort of already seeing that anyway. And if those bigger schools can offer that full cost of attendance, that extra little stipend, then I think not a lot really needs to change. If they can implement that, those smaller schools can still get their paycheck games. They're not going to touch the NCAA basketball tournament. It's going to be a football-only deal. Reasonably and legally can exist under the purview of the tax-exempt status of the NCAA. So I think we're headed to that sooner rather than later. I don't think it's going to happen in 5 years, but it wouldn't surprise me at all if it was within 10.
Well, you talked about it in one of your tweets here recently, about the draft and the correlation between stars in high school. And I'm a big proponent of the recruiting sites. I mean, yes, every now and again, you'll have a five-star that doesn't pan out necessarily. I look back at Alabama's 2008 class. They had three five-stars. One of them was Julio Jones. The other one was Tyler Love. The other one, Burton Scott. Two of them didn't pan out. But, for the most part, I think five-stars do pan out. And you look at this past NFL draft, I think the recruiting rankings ended up winning, didn't they?
Oh, yeah, 11 of the 12 SEC players drafted were four- or five-star picks. That was the continuation of a trend. 91% of the SEC's first-round picks in the last 3 years have been four or five stars in the 24/7 composite. So, yeah, it's there are misses, but I think the misses of the five-star players sort of dominates headlines because you really can't account for people that are just flat-out head cases or don't, develop or whatever. They hit. Most of the four or five-star players are four or five-star players. They don't let many slide through the cracks, and I think that's a testament to those recruiting sites and the jobs that they do, making sure they get boots on the ground and see these players in high school and get accurate grades for these players. So it is pretty impressive. I think if you look at the first round, you'll see that even the number one overall pick was a two-star player. But in the SEC, if you're a high-star value player and you go to the SEC, you're likely going to make a lot of money at the next level, and I think that's a testament to not only the recruiting sites but the coaching that exists within the SEC.
Yeah, and the science has gotten so much more accurate because really, Barrett, it's not any more fair to judge recruiting rankings versus NFL draft picks because, hey, look, the NFL misses on draft picks, and they have people dedicated to it 24/7. All they do is evaluate college prospects. The high school ranking systems like 24/7 or Rivals or whomever, they have to evaluate thousands upon thousands upon thousands of high school kids that they can get grainy videotape on sometimes. So, I mean, it's not an exact science, but it's gotten so much more accurate, and I'm a big proponent of it. So I was glad to see your tweet on that. Speaking of college and recruits and other things, contenders for next year, there are already some Vegas spreads out on some of the games. One of them that jumped out at me was Clemson's favorite over Georgia. Meanwhile, Alabama is a 22-point favorite over Virginia Tech in Atlanta.
Yeah, that Alabama line, that's a lot of points. I mean, Alabama's going to dominate Virginia Tech, but that's that's insane. You're laying 22 points, that's a lot. And I know Alabama typically comes out hot against non-conference opponents, especially when they have time to prepare, but 22 points, I mean, that's a lot. And Georgia, being a two-point dog, that's by virtue of them being on the road, I think. But Georgia, I watched that spring game. Anyone that tells you they're going to struggle on defense with the absence of all those stars hasn't seen Georgia practice and hasn't seen Georgia play, because the players they have on defense are remarkably better for that system than the ones that just left, and they had a lot of draft picks just leave. Jordan Jenkins, an outside linebacker, plays more downhill, can stop the run, is not going to get pushed around like Jarvis Jones did last year. Alec Ogletree was on skates last year at the end of the season, and Amarlo Herrera is the exact opposite of him. He plays directly downhill, which is a huge benefit. And then the two safeties they have, Josh Harvey Clemens and Trey Matthews, those guys are going to be all SEC contenders this year, and Trey Matthews is an early enrollee, and that's saying a lot about his talent. That team is an absolutely loaded football team, and if they can get through September, they're not only going to be in the discussion for the national championship. At that point, after the gauntlet they have to run through in September, they're probably going to be the front runner.
Yeah, okay, well, let's talk about them. Talk and leave off Alabama. I think that Alabama is going to start out the season probably number one. So who are your main contenders for the national championship next year?
Well, I love Georgia. I think Georgia is right there. I think you have to put Oregon and Stanford in there, of course. And in the SEC, Texas A&M will be in there. I think LSU, I'm probably in the minority, but I think people that are overlooking LSU based on the defections from that defense, I think, are kidding themselves. That defense is loaded, and that offense, even without Jeremy Hill, is going to be pretty solid with Cam Cameron leading the offense. So I think LSU's in there. Oregon, Stanford nationally. Other than that, I think, Louisville, just by virtue of the fact that, their schedule is incredibly easy. So I think those teams are going to be in the mix. I think you may see, Clemson or some other teams kind of on the periphery, but those five, I think, are a pretty solid starting five.
Well, Barrett, thanks so much for being with us, bud. And listen, we want to have you on a little bit more as college football season grows near. Love your site, and I'm going to tell everybody how they can follow you on Twitter.
Well, you can follow me on Twitter at Barrett Sallee, BarrettSallee. And you can bookmark the dedicated SEC blog on Bleacher Report, which is what I update. It's bleacherreport.com/SEC blog.
All right, buddy. Thanks again, and we'll have you on again soon, okay?
All right, my pleasure. Thanks for having me.
That was Barrett Sallee from bleacherreport.com. Go check them out today. They got a fantastic site. And again, this segment was brought to you by Russell Medical Center. And I did get a text while this was going on. I want to thank Anderson Radney, son of Thomas Radney here in town. Thomas, of course, sponsors several of our things for BRHS. Anderson texted me that John Carroll is leading BRHS right now on the boys' side 2-0, and the BRHS girls, they did fall earlier 1-0. That's going to do it for this segment. We'll be back in just a minute with more Sportz Blitz Live.